Today on the show, I am chatting with Kiran Sahota, a social historian, researcher, and public speaker of South Asian history with a special focus on women. Kiran splits her time between London and Birmingham, England. We chat about growing up in Birmingham, the start of her research career, that pivotal moment when she decided to quit her full-time human resources job and focus full-time on women in history, her family's path from India to England, and the film project she is currently working on with the help of the military. What I did totally forget to discuss with her was her stint as an Olympic torch relay person representing England leading up to the 2012 Olympics, but everything else and so much more coming up, so stay tuned. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
You're quite welcome. And I always love to tell people how I know my guests. And you actually go back a long way. This is the first time that we've actually met, even though it's virtual. You are coming to us from Birmingham, England. And I actually met your sister in 1998. She was in fourth grade. I was in England doing part of my student teaching for my master's program. And she befriended me in her class. And we have stayed friends ever since. And as a result of that, I've gotten to know you through social media. And so I'm so excited to finally get to meet you today. So let's sum up really what you currently do. Like what all is involved in your current job?
So if you're a history lover, you're going to love what I do. So I delve into history and I research it. So I get to look at objects and documents and archives. But I specialize in South Asian history from a women's perspective. And I think women have been overlooked so long in history.
I agree.
That's why I love my job.
I totally agree. Even growing up, they just kind of, you know, skimmed over the women's part in so many of the stories. And it really, really is important that we share all those because they're amazing women. And a lot of them are not even famous. You know, it's the everyday person that you come in contact with that's really, really fascinating. So how did you get, so you grew up in Birmingham, England. How did you get into history?
I won't bore your listeners with the long-winded story, but just a little bit of background. So I came from a working class family, just a normal family, and at school I was always into the arts, like whether it be drama, whether it be English, and so history was really boring. Now, American history is so different to how we're taught in the UK. So when we were taught British history, it was all about the wars and look at the courageous men's story. So I never really took an interest apart from Henry VIII and his six wives, because the drama involved in all that interested me, but I didn't come to it. So I went into doing an English and American studies degree at university. And it was the last, I think the 10 years now, that I became intrigued because, you know, there was a centenary of the First World War here being celebrated in the UK. And I do apologize to the listeners. I'll be making a lot of UK references.
That's okay.
I'm not sure how it was in the US. But here in the UK, they wanted to have a big celebration about the centenary of the First World War. And I started looking from my own family history, and I realized that we had no links to military, but there must be stories of women, and that's right. How I slowly got involved. I mean, I was working full time as a job. I was working as a HR consultant, and I said, well, let me just see what I can find. And to be truthful, I didn't find anything at first.
Right.
I didn't, and it was a shame. But as I started digging, and there's more community projects being showcased on TV, I contacted a lecturer who lived in the north of England, and he said, well, did you know there was letters that you might be interested in? So I went and I found letters from Indian soldiers, and it was that they were having, this was the first time that they'd traveled from India to Europe. So they were being placed in France, And those that were injured ended up at Brighton Pavilion Hospital, which is south of the UK, and it's about a 2-hour journey from London. So right. I found all these, and I just wanted to share everything with everybody.
One thing I do want to for our American listeners is the one thing that I realized in when I was over there in the, it was November and December of 1998, the first thing that I was just amazed at was over there, there's evidence of the wars everywhere because the war took place in Europe. You know, and so even bullets in the building walls, but I mean, there was, and there were celebrations and memorials all the time going on. And in the United States, we don't ever see that because we didn't have those battles on our soil. So for me, it was such a stark difference from how we live over here. Sure, even the Civil War, we'll see some of those, but a lot of those battlefields are really far out. They're not in the cities. And so you don't see that evidence. And so that was the one thing that really was just so eye-opening, was that the war's effect was just everywhere. You could just see everywhere where that happened.
I was going to say that is so true, because there's not a very big mention of American contribution in First World War. I mean, I haven't come across it. But as we head on to Second World War, there's an interesting piece, because there are documents out there that you have contributed. And it feels like we're so far apart. Like everybody else, like the Commonwealth countries all celebrate together. And then there's the US by itself. Yeah. Yes. But there were American troops in India for the Second World War as well. You know, the Pearl Harbor, and we celebrate VJ Day, which is victory over Japan. So when Indian troops were fighting, they were actually joined by American soldiers and the British soldiers.
Right.
But you won't find that evidence everywhere in the UK, but we do have memorial sites, you know, spread across the country. And there's American soldiers next to British soldiers and Jewish soldiers. So there are war graves. And for those that are interested, the Commonwealth War Graves Commission, they've got a website. You can find a loved one on there. And it doesn't matter if you're not in the UK. You can be all over the world. So if you've had a loved one from, I don't know, New York, who contributed to Second World War, and they died out in India or Japan, you go on their website and you type in the name and it'll come up where they've been buried, an actual site. So it pinpoints it. And if they're not buried there, if they're buried in France or Germany, they'll give you the site, and you can actually print out a certificate as well. So they give you all the details.
That's awesome. So I'll get that site information and then I'll put it into the show notes once we get the podcast published. So you became interested in that. So how did that then parlay into what you do now? Because now this is your full-time job, correct?
Yes.
So how did that happen?
I think slowly and slowly, because as you can imagine, topics like this are dominated by men talking about men's experiences. And as I was flicking through the letter, there was boxes and boxes of, there's thousands of letters, I realized that let's do an exhibition. And the exhibition really helped me cement my place here in history, doing these kind of projects. Because we opened it up and I thought nobody would come. And we had a 3-month run at a local exhibition. And I was begging my friends and family could just come to make it look like numbers. And you know, I'm from an Indian family. So we were like dragging my cousins, everybody that would listen. And slowly started catching attention. What is this woman doing telling men's stories? So my first project looked at Indian soldiers who were awarded the Victoria Cross.
Okay.
Because I don't think that many people know that unless you were awarded like a Victoria Cross, the everyday person just got lost. And the difference, and for your South Asian audiences that will be listening who are based in America, if in India at that time, men, the everyday person, the everyday man, was illiterate, so they wouldn't be able to read and write. Yeah. And then we, in 1947, we had partition, which divided India and Pakistan. So our documents got destroyed. Right. So the only documents that you can get is anyone awarded a cross, a Victoria Cross. And so that's where the momentum came. And then I never stopped, because more and more people would come, and women especially, we don't have a history background. Where did you get this information, and can you teach us? And so I started doing educational programs and workshops, and that then built up onto a second project. And now the Indian Women and War is the third national project, having an exhibition and filming and all the other nice treats. But this is just for Indian women and looking at their stories and experiences.
Right. So where did you have a hard time getting funding for this? For this to be your full-time job, you have to be getting paid. So how did you get the funding for the whole project?
When I first started, because there was a big launch of making sure that everybody's involved in the celebration of the centenary of the First World War, I didn't realize at the time I was allowed funding. But talking to other people, they said, if you've got this idea, why don't you just apply and we'll support you? And it was academics supporting me. So I went and I got £10,000. And for my first project, I didn't get paid anything. Right. Because by the time you bought boards, I was a bit naive. I didn't know. I think I only got like £25 out of it. But that was fine. But then going on to other projects, I think they just realized that because I don't come from an academic background or I'm not military related, the stories that I'm focusing on relate to the communities around me. Right. And so that's where funding came from, and they got bigger and bigger. So, you know, outside of the projects, I also get paid to speak and present my work. So, you know, the momentum and the legacy of the projects carry on because there's such an interest, and a lot of women are not leading projects like this. I don't know how it is in the US and other parts of the country, but in my circle, I really have formed kind of like a fan base of women who come to me and want to know more. And that just shows funders and private donors that it's worth investing in, because everybody wants to have access to this education.
So I'm going to ask this question. So what was it like when you quit your full-time job to do this?
Like, scary.
Yeah, I can bet. So how did you make that decision? Like, was it something that took like a really long time for you to build up to do that? Because that is, you're going from guaranteed regular steady income to this passion project that relies on funding. So that has to be scary.
Definitely was scary. I think, you know, we went into a job and I was secured a pension and I knew I could have off days and annual leave. But this is, I think the women and the communities, honestly, there was such a need for it. It was either now or never. Right. And because momentum had built up for my first project, for the second one, there was such a build up of what is Kiran going to do? And I thought, well, okay, let's do this. But, you know, it wasn't so easy, because at the same time, I've been a carer for my grandfather, who was disabled, and I've been his carer since I was 17, officially, but I always looked after him when I was young anyway. And it was such a juggle, because when you're paying for someone's healthcare bills and you're paying for carers and in-house support, to leave a secure job, to then go into a job. Remember, this is not science, or this is not finance, or this is not, you know, those secure jobs where you know you can get work. The arts is always up and down, and any actor or anybody in the creative industry can understand that it's not like we are going to be here for 10 years.
Right.
And there's always a demand for this work. So it played heavy on my heart. But I think I just gambled it and it paid off.
Right.
It's not as lucrative as I thought, but I love waking up every day doing the things I do and talking about it with lovely women like yourselves and others.
Yeah.
You can't get really angry about researching women's history.
No, and I think that, a lot of times I think that how happy, how you feel about what you do every day in some ways is more than money. You can't really put a price tag on your mental health and how you love getting up every day and doing what you do. I think that's really important. How have your parents been through this?
They've been great, actually. I think my father still doesn't know what I do. He thinks he thinks I'm employed by the army. My mum kind of, she just thinks I do exhibitions all the time. And my house is full of books of history and
Right.
articles. And the only one thing I would say is that when you do this kind of work, you never allowed any time for yourself in the creative. So you forget, whereas you can leave your work at 5 o'clock in an office and you can have drinks with your friends. When you're in the middle of a project, especially if it's going to go up and down the country and it's going to go
Right.
nationwide, it's like if you're preparing to go on tour. So you're never in one
Sure.
city for, I mean, I feel like I'm Beyonce some of the times on tour.
I totally get it. And I work for myself 3/4 of the week, and I work out of my house. So yeah, I mean, like last night, I didn't finish working really until 8:30. And it is true. You don't always have that structure. And there are days I don't even remember what day it is. So, it gets like that. Do you think that you will have the goal of having an exhibition outside of England?
I mean, we have done it before, and that was because a private donor had paid for me to go over to France, and he paid for all the shipping costs and everything. And I didn't realize there was such a big demand for this outside of the UK,
Right.
because in the second project, I looked at more the letters I was referring to before, where men were talking about women being educated. And so we're always looking at opportunity outside of the UK. It just literally, COVID came and the pandemic
Right.
shut everything down. But that doesn't mean that there's not demand. I mean, I do go overseas and do talks. I've done festivals as well before. So I don't bring the entire exhibition out with me, but I alone then come out and do a presentation and bring one or two things out, which is always lovely because you're always nervous, is even
Yeah.
if one person comes. So like for me, if I know I've got to do anything in the UK, I always call my family members, just come in your little group, at least there's a guaranteed audience. And then I'm surprised when the room packs up. And I did have a little letter I wanted to share with
Sure.
Michelle, because when we talk about men and women, I found a letter actually. I thought that you might like to, if I could share it with you. But
Absolutely.
this is a letter from Jay Singh, who was based in France, to Sardar Singh back in Punjab, dated the 6th of November 1917. So this talks about adventures because they've never traveled from India anywhere. So he goes, I'm off to Paris, and Paris is a city of fairyland, and God will now give us an opportunity of seeing it. I tend to enjoy whatever pleasures there are. I would like to marry in France, but I am afraid of the family would be ashamed. You can marry very fine girls here if you like. And
So
this is the kind of, oh, sorry.
who is he writing to? So, I mean, is that another a man, or is it a woman, or is it?
It's a man to another man,
Okay.
but I don't know the relationships because I found the letters in my research. But I wanted to say that the reason I pick letters like this is, A, the way that men talk about women.
Yes.
In First World War, in my research, women, apart from Princess Sophia Dilip Singh, who was connected to royalty and the goddaughter of Queen Victoria at the time, the everyday woman was only spoken about in letters. So you never heard a response back from the woman. And what men would do, this refers to only the South Asian men that I've researched, so I can't speak for Black or African soldiers, but they would compare Indian women to European women, and especially those that they're meeting in France or they're meeting in the UK. And it was, I connect it to today because women, despite your race or ethnicity, we're still being compared. Men still yes. talk about us in such wording we wouldn't use ourselves. Right. So 100 years on from writing these letters, nothing really has changed in the language.
Can you read that one part again in the letter where they're referring to the women?
Yes, he goes, I should like to marry in France, but I am afraid of the family because they would be ashamed. You can marry very fine girls here if you like.
Yeah.
And it was the chance because after the war, especially First World War, you know, men, if they weren't married before they came to war, they would have to get married to Indian women. And, you know, there was such, there's not so much taboo right now, but in those days, you couldn't marry outside of your race yeah. and your ethnicity.
Right.
And so he knew if he settled in France with a white woman, you know, a European young lady, that his family would be ashamed and they would talk about it in the village. Why isn't your son returned from war?
Right.
So they didn't really talk about relationships. So I find it really interesting. And the way that at the end, you can marry very fine girls here if you like.
Right.
You know, Indian women in the letters are never spoken about in this way, but there's something exotic about European women.
I think that's the case though. It's kind of like the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. I think that no matter where you are, anything that's outside of the normal seems exotic to people, whether it's, you know, the European women, or if you look at the other ethnicities and referring to them as exotic, you know, the word exotic is relevant to whatever is the opposite of what I think of what they are living around. But you're right. That's very interesting. So currently what's the project you're working on?
So I'm currently working on my third project, which is Indian Women and War. And it really looks at the contribution of the everyday women that they made to Second World War. And then we link it in talking to women currently in the British Army, the British Air Force and the Royal Navy about their experiences. So we're connecting past histories to present day history, because I think a lot of people forget that when we talk about history, they're only so fixated on the past. Oh, this lady done this, or, you know, this story and this experience. We forget that there's women today, whether it's in the British Army or in the US Army, that are, you know, so we can go to sleep at night. They're doing a job that we definitely can't. And I think they're so overlooked. So I was on an army base earlier this week, actually, just looking at the site and seeing where we can film. And it's really interesting because it would be nice to compare how women are currently serving, what their experiences are like compared to, you know, 100 years ago when women were trying to get into the armed forces. So it's really an exciting project. We've been a bit quiet because of the COVID pandemic.
Right.
But we're really interested because this is the first time a project has been funded to talk about women across the services. It's not just the women in the army. We're looking at the RAF and we're looking at the Royal Navy. And I couldn't believe that in the Second World War, Indian women were allowed to go aboard a ship. And
Really?
Yes. I don't have the photographs because we haven't been allowed in the museum because of the COVID restrictions. But yeah, just before we got into lockdown in 2020, we were off to see these photographs, Indian women aboard a ship. And there's only a small percentage now of women in the Royal Navy here in the UK. of who are, come from South Asian heritage. So it's really interesting because we don't hear these stories and we don't hear them thinking about women on sea and serving for their country. So it'll be interesting to see what we can find.
What you mentioned of filming, so have you been to a lot of military bases as a result of starting to do this film?
Yeah, you know what, I've got to say I'm a very, very lucky woman. I have, and it's a bit complicated because when we think of the armed forces, we think that they're quite restricted, so they're like this, and I did have preconceptions, but since doing this kind of work, to be honest, they keep opening the doors, like, do you want to film here, and do you think that we can be here, and do you want to come and visit?
That's amazing.
Do you want to come to this event? And you know, coming from the backgrounds that we came from and having a limited education, it's so exciting to see the other side, but also see them as human beings, because as you can imagine, you know, the armed forces, and I'm not advocating for any, you know, I'm not pro this or pro that, but I think we forget that these men and women are human beings doing the job.
Right.
And they don't make the rules, they follow the rules. So if the order is, you know, you need to be based here, that's where you need to go. So it was earlier this week, I went on an army base to see where we can possibly film. And more of that will be coming up. So those that want to follow me on social media.
Yes. What is your Instagram account?
It's at BIMCIC. So it's BIMCIC. And we'll be doing some behind the scenes footage, and the actual, because we're making a film, it should be released early next year, fingers crossed, if we don't have another lockdown. Okay. But it's been great going to different bases and seeing and comparing them as well. So we have the headquarters that I regularly attend and have meetings at, and then the smaller bases as well.
Right.
And it's fascinating to see what goes on behind the scenes.
It really is. What is one place that you would like to go to that you've never been? It could be related to whatever. I know I threw that one out there.
Do you know where I like to go to? And this is not an army, but the White House.
I'd love for you guys to come over. I know Aman came over. She took this over weekend trip and was like, hey, I'm in the US. Sorry, I don't have time to see you.
Yeah.
I'd love for you guys to come over here. I've been to DC twice, and the last time was just a few years ago. It's, you know, for me, I kind of do the same thing. It doesn't matter where I go. I always try to imagine, and I did the same thing in Europe. I always try to imagine what was it like to stand here in this place where these people did this thing? And it's always really surreal. In some of the places, especially where battles happen, they're beautiful areas. Mm-hmm. And you can't imagine, it's hard to even think about all of the bodies that were there and things like that. But it's really, I went to George Washington's house, which is 15 minutes from downtown Washington. And it's right on the Potomac River. And the back of the house is, there's a huge long porch along the very back of the house. And there's all these rocking chairs, and you can just sit there and look at the river. And you know, you sit there, and I was like, so nothing has really changed from when he was alive, you know, the house, the river, just the things that you see across may be different. But he stood out there in the same thing and looked at the river like we are now. And for me, it's just those moments where, I don't know, it gives you kind of chills of excitement or something to see all that. So yeah, I get excited about all that.
But also I was going to say about the White House, if you think about the rich history, the first women, you know, not from a male perspective.
Yes.
You know, Hillary Clinton, I think that's when everyone across the country really took notice of, oh my God, she's not just, you know, Bill Clinton.
Right.
This is a woman who is trying to run and hope she gets elected. And then we had Michelle Obama, First Lady. Right. I think there's such a rich history in those stories and experiences. And I know, like, I'm a big fan of the program Scandal with Kerry Washington.
Yes, I have.
But, you know, if those walls could talk, and
I know.
However we think of, you know, it's here as well in the UK, whatever we think of prime ministers and presidents, there's always a woman who's the backbone, and whether that she's had to give up, you know, family life to support her husbands. And some of these women, the everyday women that I talk about, when their husbands went off to war, they were left looking after the children and looking after farming land, and they didn't know if they're going to come and go, or like what's going to happen in the war, because Second World War was such a, it's a worldwide war. It was a great war because it affected every country. Every country was involved, and we never knew how long it was going to take. So, you know, when Hitler got defeated, there was still that other war. This, you know, we concentrate on the European war with Hitler, but then there was this other war against Japan that they were like, they can't come into India. So everyone really had to join into that war. And I think that part of the war where there were more, the US Army was involved, I think that's the forgotten war. And I say that again and again, because those stories are not told enough. We talk about the European aspect of it, and we're taught in schools, I don't know in the US about it, that, but in the UK, it was Britain against Germany, and then we seem to forget.
Yeah. But
the war didn't just end then, it ended years later, you know, sometime later, with this other battle in a land that most people were like, oh, well, we didn't know that happened. And so that's why I do the job that I do. And, you know, everywhere's got such rich history. You know, the White House, again, as I mentioned, you know, that was involved in making decisions forward about wars as well.
Right.
So after Second World War, although that was the greatest war, we do have wars, and protecting our country, that's where all the decisions are made. So the histories in those, and when files can get classified, that's always my dream. Like, okay, we can look at this.
You know, I was speaking about the first ladies. CNN did a series on just a few of them, but I watched the one on Eleanor Roosevelt, and I didn't know, I just didn't know in detail all the things. Like, basically, she was the person that went everywhere, because he could not. And it was really fascinating how much she was for certain changes, especially where it came to women, and how there were people that just hated her. And even like the FBI had a file on her and all these, you know, it was just, I had forgotten, or maybe I wasn't even taught that much about her. And, you know, so many times I think we take for granted certain positions. And I think sometimes that's the first ladies, and you don't really pay attention to what they do and how that impacts. Just like women running farms when their men go off to war, people don't think about the women that had to run, good or bad, this is no judgment, the plantations in the American South. They had to run that. They had to do everything while their men went off to war. And the same thing in any country that had some type of farming, in some type of war, the women end up taking care of everything. And that those stories are not told. It's always the men are the heroes, and the women are, well, they're just at home. And their contribution is so rich. And I just think that's wonderful that you are looking to share those stories.
And I think that's what's happened the last few years. There's been this big momentum of looking at women in history that we can all relate to. So it's not the privileged women, you know, who went off to universities, and those were far and few between in South Asian women. But the big push has come when everyday people are saying, well, what about women like me who are juggling 10,000 things? And I think back then we were juggling so much as well, like the comparisons that you make. But they've been overlooked. And it depends on who's telling these histories. And, you know, I'm not bashing men. I never have done. But most military history is taught by men, whether that's here in the UK or worldwide. If you look at festivals, you know, anything military related, the experiences, it's told by men. And here come women saying, well, actually, let's change the narrative. And I think that's one of the things I'm very vocal about. Let's change the narratives to include all the narratives about this. So when, you know, these letters, they weren't written yesterday. So when I came across letters from 1917 or 1914, I was like, but why have we never been taught that? Why have we never included that? And I, that's where the interest comes from, because we're opening up Pandora's box. And making history fun again, I think. I think it's been seen as dull and all men, male dominated.
Yes, I agree.
And here comes somebody with pink lipstick and, and says, well, let's break the rules and let's not put these like stories into boxes. Let's talk about how women are spoken about, because nothing changes. But I think men don't realize that. I think when they compare it to now, they think, oh, well, you know, they're heroes and they fought for their country, but that's fine. But look at what women are going through now. So a lot of these things that men are writing about compares to what women are going through today. And we're often compared. Social media has made sure that we have the filters. And so it's so sad that when I read this and I present the work, we often have conversations about where is a woman's place today? And you know, can't you move up? Women are moving up ranks as well in the armed services. And, you know, what, when is a woman deemed too intelligent or on, you know, on the ranking side? So there's always a big debate, but by that time I've done my presentation and I'm off home and I let the men figure it out, because men will never understand women.
So you said your film that it should be out sometime next year.
Yes.
And is that your first film project that you've been involved in?
Yes. So it's quite interesting. Whenever you do anything in the creative world, whatever you've done before, you don't want to keep doing that. So I realized that I keep doing exhibitions, but most of the young people and our communities are not going into those spaces unless they're invited by me. So we're creating an online exhibition, so anyone can then log onto my website once it's all completed, once the project's finished, get interactive, and we'll be having like worksheets. And if you're a teacher, it doesn't matter if you're in the UK or whether you're in the US, you can download stuff for students and teach that in the classroom. But we've got little short films. They'll be about 10, 15 minutes. We've got one for the Army, one for the Royal Air Force, and one for the Royal Navy. And we'll be talking about women's experiences. And it gives you a taster of the research that we're doing. We didn't just do one big film because audiences get bored, because if they see history and they're not like, they don't like history, they'll be like, oh well, we don't want to do that. So what I found working with young people is smaller films that you can get then when you're walking around, and you can download that as well, and you can watch it in your own time. So it'll be informative, but you'll be fun because it's all women. And I also employ an all-women team as well where I can. So from the photographer to the lady that's doing our film to, you know, the people that run the social media. I've been really, really been pushing for all this because we talk about women empowerment. Right. But what is women empowerment just outside of words? So I've been really pushing that. My sister has been involved. Sometimes she doesn't want to do it, but she's forced to do it.
As sister, you know,
because the biggest support comes from your family, and we don't talk about that. You know, to push these projects through, it's great that everybody wants it out there, but sometimes we go into spaces where we're not welcome. So you need that support. So family has been really part of the whole journey of, don't be afraid to tell those stories, or don't be afraid to research that. And I don't, I try not to talk about it yet because I don't have the full picture, but we also in the project will be talking about women being used for prostitution
right.
during war services as well. And we don't talk about that side because that's seen as seedy, and for some reason it seemed even in history as it's the women's fault when they were used for these services. So we'll be talking about the war, and as much as I talk about it being fun, but we'll also be bringing out the darker side of the reality and the consequences, because these women then weren't allowed to go back to their villages because people had been told about what they had been doing. So although they were forced to do it, these women had no choice to do it. So it's not all, you know, welcome and here it is. Right. And we talk about these stories of these everyday women, then that they were left. And this is talking about India, you know, 85 years ago. They couldn't go back to their villages, couldn't be remarried, couldn't go on to have families. And I think when we talk about women today, we've got so many choices. We can come out of a relationship, or we can change jobs, and, you know, we can use our voice, and we've got social media then to talk about, you know, issues that affect us. But back then, these women couldn't speak out. So it does go a bit dark, but I think that's
okay. I think that's good, because you're giving voice to every woman, good or bad, because, you know, history can't just be pretty. History has to show the whole story. And, you know, there are times when I'm out somewhere and it may be a site of a controversial subject, and I think, well, maybe I shouldn't post this on social media. But then I'm like, I'm here to photograph history. I'm not here to edit history. Mm. I'm here to tell the story, good, bad, or ugly. And I think that's important that you give voice to those women, because they couldn't speak for themselves. And I think that's important.
And it's a shame, because I was trying to find out if those women were still alive, so we can capture them in the film. But we can't, because they're everyday women, and then they were abandoned. It's so hard to find out. But, you know, when you talk about taking pictures at controversial sites, you know, I think in history what's happening is, when we go to a site, especially myself as a historian who's now coming in but having no history degree, I always make sure, why am I here and what can I get out of it? What is it that I'm learning? So I've learned to go to certain places and I take a photograph and then I write about what I learned.
Right.
You know, what I was pre-thinking before I got to a site. What was I thinking? Just like with the army blogs that I write. When I first went in, I thought it was going to be, it was all white and they're all privileged. And then as I started working with them, I realized that actually they come from all backgrounds. So I do that in my writing and give people a bigger picture of what I've learned. And I've learned not to be so judgmental when it comes to the armed forces. But, you know, we have the best time. And history, you can't erase history. You can only learn from it.
That's right.
And once you find out, especially in like Black and South Asian history, we're always willing to talk about it and help you fill in those gaps. And that's what we've been doing with our community members when they talk about, well, we don't know what happened or where do we come from. We've been able to piece in those puzzles. It's like a jigsaw puzzle with 1,000 pieces.
Sure.
And some pieces will always be left out because we'll never get a clearer picture. But slowly working together and getting people to understand our histories, we can start putting pieces together. And I think those are the best education classes outside of school, because we're talking to actual people. And somebody might say, well, I didn't know that, because there's so much about Black history that I didn't know.
Right.
And we live in such a diverse area. And I, you know, most of my class were full of, you know, like young Black men and women. And I didn't realize that there's so much that I didn't know. But working with them on projects and researching has been fascinating. And there's links all over. It's not just in the UK. You find a story in the US, you find a story in Australia, and you think, what were they doing in Norway? And they were in Norway. And so it's piecing those pieces together. And young people love it. They love learning about this.
Sure.
And being educated. So I think that is a service and a justice that we're doing.
One last thing, and then we're going to go. But you are of Indian descent, your family. So how long is your family first generation, or was your grandfather born in the UK as well?
No, well, what's interesting, my grandparents from both sides, from my mother and my father's side, were born in India. Okay. And my grandfather, so we call it in Punjabi, my nana and nani, which is my gran and grandfather. They were in India, and there was a call from, so the British had a call out. They needed people in England from India to help clear up from the Second World War. Right. So my grandfather was a farm worker. So he saw somebody in the village was like, do you want to go to get a good, better life? And so he said he had cousins already here who were educated. So he was like, well, okay, I'll go. And there was about 10, 15 of them from the village
right.
that were given the papers, told where to go. And they went from the Punjab, a 7-hour drive to Delhi. Then they had to go to Bombay, and then they arrived in the UK. So he arrived actually in London. So hence why my links to London are not just for work. And he was East London. And so he had family there, and then he called my grandmother over. And so my mother is first generation and I am the second generation. And it's been amazing because my grandfather and grandmother have now passed, but my grandfather got to see some of the work that I did, and he was so proud that we're connecting these links. It makes me sad because he had dementia at the end. So, so
when we're both going to be crying.
Yeah, we are. When we talk about linkage, you know, especially for myself, I found out that we're not just placed in India, although I do go back. Because my grandfather had a brother out there. We do go back to India where it's permitting, but my grandfather traveled just to make sure that we had this great life.
Right.
And, you know, looking into my own research and covering South Asian history, it just makes it a lot stronger because I realized that they were born in an era where war was. Right. And my grandfather lost his mother quite young. So he must have only been about 4 or 5 when he lost.
Oh, wow, her. Yeah.
So he didn't really get to, but he is such an advocate for women, you know, in our family. And that's why my sister is the way she is and I'm the way I am, because he really pushed for us. He said, this is all I can give you.
Right.
Take the free education that they give you. But if you ever need love and support, then I've got that in bundles. But money-wise, he was normal working class. So to have this and go to events, that I like to meet the royal family, which we did do in a project in 2018, and have conversation about just how far we've come. It made me so proud, and he got to see that because the legacy that we leave is not just in the history work, it's opening the doors for people to have conversations,
sure.
which is sometimes difficult. And it's so sad when they're not here no more, because my grandfather would have talked about partition and what that was like, and women being separated, and you know, Muslims were in one sector and Indians were in one sector and getting killed. It was the biggest mass migration of its time. So it's, you know, it's amazing to now connect to those with the sad history that India has because of First World War, Second World War, and then partition to where we are today. And the UK, one thing I've got to say is the free education up until when you're 16. And even if you want to go to college, so that's from 16 years of age to 18, it's all free here. So we really grasped that and took every opportunity. And we had great teachers, and now I've got great mentors in the history world that really helped me do that. So I can't complain, you know, how far I've come, because it's been a great support and just great mentors. But hopefully there's more projects like this to come for the next 10-15 years, and then by that time if I can retire, give it to the young people.
I just think that it's really, really wonderful. And I'm so excited to see your films and see where you go from here and just everything about it. I'm going to cut this off now, if you'll just hang on. Thank you so much for being on today.
Thank you.
Friends, I hope you enjoyed today's conversation with Kiran. We both so appreciate you tuning in today. If you really loved this episode, please screenshot it and share it on your Instagram stories, tagging both Kiran at BIMCIC and me at A Southern Girl's View. Don't worry, I'll put this on the show notes. You can learn more about her organization, Believe in Me, at www.bimcic.com. As a reminder, if you're not already subscribed to my podcast, I want to encourage you to go and do that today. I really don't want you to miss a single upcoming episode. You can subscribe at southerngirlsview.com/podcast. You can also find me on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen to podcasts. And if you're feeling extra warm and fuzzy today, I would be so grateful if you left me a review over on iTunes as well. Those reviews help people not only find my podcast, but they're also fun for me to go in and read and see which episodes and what specifically you like the best. You can click on the link in the show notes and go to iTunes, find my podcast, and then select ratings and review and write a review. And then let me know what the favorite part of your podcast is. Until next time, stay safe and have a fantastic rest of the day.